Series shuffle continues here at Daytona International Speedway. It's the nationwide series turn once again to take on the 2.5 mile super speedway. We had rain early on in the day that screwed everything up as far as the schedule here at Daytona Beach. 63 degrees now, mostly cloudy, but hopefully we will not have any more precipitation falling from the sky for this final practice of the day for the Nationwide Series. Hello, everyone. Darrell Waltrip sticks around for this Nationwide practice with Phil, and I'm Rick Allen. Now, we saw in the first practice speeds over 200 miles an hour, and it looks as though NASCAR thinks that might be a little fast.
Yeah, I was over with Robin Pemberton over in the NASCAR control tower, and as soon as they hit 200, the call was made.
That magic number.
Yeah, it's not a good idea for this series, with as many different variations of drivers that you have with experience levels, to run that fast. So I applaud the fact that they slowed them down a little bit. We'll see how much.
You know, that first practice session, we saw cars running packs, and then we saw cars run by themselves. Even by themselves, DW, they were up over 188, yeah. 188 and a half. So that's a lot faster than these cars have been in a long time. And I think NASCAR said, okay, we don't want them to run that fast, I don't think, by themselves. Or certainly in the draft, we don't want to see speeds upwards of 200 miles an hour.
They'd go over 200 because that was really just a broken up kind of a draft. They got hooked up right. I think you'd have seen 203 maybe.
And remember, that was the first practice session these guys have ever had on the race on this new surface here with the Nationwide cars.
Danica Patrick first out on the racetrack for the second practice for the Nationwide Series. And we're seeing a lot of cars already on the racetrack, and we're not going to see single car runs, it looks like, at the beginning of this practice. They all race to get out there to get track time.
I think Danica is the one that's going to try to get a mock qualifying run in here before the racetrack gets too busy.
Yeah, it really and truly, these cars, they can't work on them. So, you know, whatever they qualify with is what they're going to race with. So you might as well get out there, I think, and work on your race setup and be comfortable for the race. Don't worry about running by yourself.
You know what we saw a lot, Darrell, in that first practice session was so many cars that were bottoming out, even by themselves, and then they got in the draft running 10 miles an hour faster, and they were dragging all the way through the turns.
Yep.
Danica Patrick running way up high on the racetrack. Up to speed. Now the big group is behind her. Right there. We're seeing the groups running together in a pack. Again, sparks flying early on in this session.
But listen, Rick, that's not all that unusual. You'll lower the air pressure down a little bit. Pick if you're going to go out and run several laps. So you got low air pressure and the skirts that are on the side of these cars, you go out with them as close to the ground as you can and let them wear off. You want it to wear off so you'll know exactly how much to trim it back, and then you won't do that anymore.
Again, the way this practice started off, we saw the single car of Danica Patrick, and as soon as she made it onto the racetrack and was clear, this large group followed out behind. Kyle, sparks coming from
Kyle Busch's car. Yeah, Kyle Busch's car all the way around the racetrack. He said after the first practice that they were dragging. They had to work on it and clearing some stuff, but apparently not enough yet. Remember, these guys and girls have a little less, smaller tapered spacer openings, so they're down some horsepower. Now we're waiting to get confirmation from NASCAR as to how much exactly they think that horsepower loss is.
Yeah, well, right now the first time about 192.3, and they were 200 in that first practice. We'll see if they pick it up a little bit. They should. Yeah, now they're up to 194. So I don't know what they did, but I think they got it just right.
Let's go down to the garage and Ray Dunlap.
Well, thank you, Rick. You know, when we come to Daytona, there's always so many stories. Obviously, when Danica's here, everybody's watching. But this year, I think the biggest story is the fact that NASCAR made all the drivers declare for running in only one championship. You had to decide, do you want to be the Cup champion, Nationwide or Camping World Trucks? And that's going to play out a big story throughout the season here in this garage. Obviously, whenever you're looking at this field, you're talking about guys like Kyle Busch, Tony Stewart, Dale Jr., Carl Edwards, lots of guys that could win here. But how about the championship in 2011? I think it very well may come down to Elliott Sadler, Eric Almirola, and possibly Brian Scott. Those are three guys that I've got my eye on for the 2011 Nationwide Championship. But there's a lot going on in this garage area, and one of those things is the fact that there is a change under the hood. And for more on that, let's go to my good friend Wendy Venturini.
Thank you, Ray. Rule changes, rule changes, rule
rule changes, the story in the Cup garage, now the story in the Nationwide garage. 1 hour ago, we had practice in Nationwide, and since then, we've made a huge change with these tapered spacers. NASCAR came through in that hour off and made smaller tapered spacers, given them to the crews throughout the whole garage area. What is that loss of horsepower? I'm hearing from all the engine tuners, anywhere from 20 horsepower to 30 horsepower different. Keep in mind, the speeds that we had in that first practice session were almost faster than the Cup cars over there. This was the reason why we had to slow down these Nationwide cars, get them at a slower speed. So 20 to 30 horsepower is what we're going to estimate. We're going to continue to follow in this practice, but Phil Parsons, the numbers for you, those new engine packages that we had, it was a decimal spacer of 0.945. They're now at 59.64s. That's a lot of numbers thrown here. And these older engines had a 61.64s. They're now at 15.16s. For all the gearheads out there, simply put, smaller taper spacers.
Yeah, because I can't write all that down that fast.
There's so many numbers.
And I don't know. Wendy, good job of just getting all that out.
I love those numbers.
Well, we're seeing 2 and 3 wide already at Daytona.
Yeah, I think here's another thing. You know, we talk about how smooth the track is, but if you want to know where any of the bumps are, just watch the sparks out of that 18 car.
Yeah,
because that's what's causing
20,
some of those.
A lot of sparks coming out from underneath both of those race cars. Both of them going 195 miles an hour is the fastest we've seen. Take a look back.
Now that's just plain old right there. Something's
looks like
dragging.
Looks like tailpipes, maybe right side of the car. That's where the tailpipes come out
right
on these cars.
Even though the 18 throwing sparks out behind him, the 18 and the 20, the fastest cars on the racetrack, over 195 miles an hour. Again, that's 5 miles off of what we saw in the first practice, where they were over 200 miles an hour. But drafting practice taking place for the Nationwide Series here on Speed.
You know, down pit road backwards.
I think I'd fix that bad boy.
Yeah.
Take a look at this. Brian Scott, damage to the left rear of that race car. That is because of a wild ride coming out of turn number 4. Let's take a look at what just happened.
Brian was in that big pack here. You see, there's Joey Logano, his teammate at Joe Gibbs Racing, pushing him coming off turn number 4. Remember, in a big pack here, he just gets a little bit of a wiggle.
Yep.
And it was just a situation where it looked like Joey was pushing on the left side and that turned his nose up to the right, and then he had to try to correct it.
That's what I've seen with some of these cars, Phil, is they're not as smooth as the Cup drivers. They get to wobbling a little bit, kind of going back and forth. And when you do that, if somebody's right behind you like Joey was there, he's going to push you around. These cars don't line up with bumpers. And these cars, wow, that was close.
Yeah, really fortunate that that was a single car incident.
Yeah, these bumpers are not quite as flat front to rear as the Cup cars are. Let's see what Danica saw here. She says, oh, I think I've seen this before.
Mm-hmm. Let me go by this before he comes back up on the racetrack. And so damage also to the 20 of Joey Logano, the right rear of that race car torn up.
Looks like
you see the front of the 6 also has problems.
It's chain reaction. When something starts to happen, that was what happened to those guys. They ran up on some cars that they were much faster than. I wouldn't be surprised if the 11 didn't have to squeeze out of the throttle just a little bit. And when he started to try to move to the left, Joey got him and turned him around.
Brian Scott, one of the names that Ray Dunlap just mentioned as far as contender for the Nationwide Series Championship in 2011. Not the start he was looking for.
Back in the day when you had to sweep it up.
Speed presentation of NASCAR Nationwide Practice from Daytona is presented by Napa. Napa know-how. Brought to you in part by ToyotaRacing.com. Sponsor Fire 3. Sponsor Fire's back, and this year, the winner gets a visit from their favorite driver. Enter at ToyotaRacing.com. And by AARP. Join Jeff Gordon in the drive to end hunger by visiting drivetoendhunger.org. Cleaning the racetrack because of this.
Brian Scott coming off turn number 4. He got wiggling just a little bit, and then by the time he finally got straight, that left Joey Logano over there on his left side, and that turned his right front corner towards the outside.
Very familiar coming out of turn number 4 to something we saw earlier today.
Same thing, running up on a bunch of cars. They're not real sure which way they're going to go. The 48 got a little bit loose. 88 checked up, and when he did, here comes a 56 with a push, and got into the back of Dale Jr.'s car, and Dale Jr. will now start at the rear of the Daytona 500.
Joey Logano explaining.
Oh yeah, he's telling him, say, when you started wobbling, when you started going left, right, I'm up on you. You can see his hands. I'm up on you. When you came across, I had nothing, you know, I got into the right side of your bumper there and pushed you around.
And we caught a glimpse of Joey's car also has some damage, as well as the six of Ricky Stenhouse in the aftermath.
Clint Boyer was standing there as well, I'm sure, trying to find out exactly what just took place.
And what happens in a wreck like that, Rick and Phil, you first thing that Brian Scott would have said, I didn't do anything wrong. But then Joey comes on and says, let me tell you what you did wrong. And then Joey's got a little bit more experience than Brian. Let me tell you what happened. And here's something you might be able to learn from what happened just now, and don't let it happen again.
And that was a situation where we talked about the similarities. The cars in front of Brian Scott weren't going as fast as he was. He was trying to figure out where to go and had someone pushing him. There's nothing he can do about the guy behind him.
And oh, by the way, this racetrack is incredibly smooth. But these cars aren't real easy to drive, especially when you have cars moving around in front of you and you get people in the back trying to push you. They're not that easy to drive. And I know I was talking to Jeff Burton the other day. I said, how much of a handful is it when you have somebody pushing you? He said, you know, they're basically steering your car for you. So you really have to be on your toes.
Well, the thing that makes the speed so high down here this time is in the past we've had bumps. Kind of the car would undulate. The car would undulate through the turns. That meant that the guy behind you could not stay on you. He had to give you some room because his car was moving up and down as well. Now you can just stay locked on. I mean, it's synchronized racing. You get hooked onto the guy in front of you, and you two can really make good time, and it's because the track is so smooth.
Now, of the two incidents we've seen today, is the problem that the guy that's pushing you can't see what's in front of you?
No, it's closing rate. The closing rate when someone is pushing you on cars that are in front of you is 10 mile an hour faster. And you've got to anticipate. You've got to be ready to make a move before you get there. You can't get there and then say, oh, wow, what am I going to do? It's too late. And that's what happened there.
Eric Almirola pushing down the backstretch.
A lot of sparks still flying out from underneath these race cars. There's Elliott Sadler in the two.
It's got to be some sort of tailpipe configuration thing that these cars have got maybe hanging down, and they're going probably faster than they thought they were going to, and they're sinking down into the racetrack.
Yeah, some of the times when the cars come on the racetrack, as we talk about, the air pressure is a little bit low. That will get better. But some cars we've seen go lap after lap after lap, given their air pressure is a chance to build up, and they're still dragging. They have to come back to the garage. And as you just raise these cars up, remember, they're not on bump stops. These Nationwide cars are on springs. They will be coil bound, so they'll just have to come in and literally turn a jack screw and raise these cars up.
Five of Dale Earnhardt Jr. in front of that 88 of Eric Almirola.
That's the company car behind him.
Remember Dale Jr. the last time at this racetrack in a Nationwide race in a number three Wrangler car, put it in victory lane.
Just under 195 miles an hour, the best lap for those two.
I think
they jumped on top of the board at 199 when they crossed the stripe that time.
Is that not indicative of what two cars hooked up can do? Our highest speed was 195 miles an hour just a few moments ago before this last completed lap. These guys hook up all the way around the racetrack, and look, they're over 199 miles an hour.
Yeah, and they're doing exactly what the cup cars are able to do. They're pushing each other. Eric is tied up right into the back of the five car of Dale Earnhardt Jr., and they're making max speed right now, buddy.
Again, closing in on that 200 mile an hour speed as we see Tony Stewart.
They just hit
it in front of Brad, and they go 202 miles an hour around Daytona.
But DW, you think we'll see maybe another tapered spacer a little bit smaller tomorrow?
The thing that keeps concerning me about some of the changes that have been made to the cup cars, and look like we probably are going to see another change here, is these speeds are being run in the evening. We ran these high speeds the other night in the Bud Shootout. We have not raced in the daytime yet. This racetrack will slow down. The ambient temperature will go up. How much, I can't really say. That's a little bit faster than I think they want to see these things run. I'd say, yeah, they're going to get another plate change.
Well, remember, we saw a 200-mile-an-hour mark put up there in our first practice. They decreased the size of the tapered spacer, and we've picked up 2 miles an hour in our second practice.
The only thing I worry about in this series, and there's nothing you can do about it, the more you slow the fast guys down, the good guys down, the more it hurts the guys mid-packing on back, because they just don't have the experience to be able to run as fast as these cup guys and guys with the good cars.
Brad Keselowski currently second quick. We go down to the garage and Wendy Venerini.
I'm with Brian Scott, one of the two guys involved in that incident. Be the eyes and the ears for us of what you felt in the race car with that draft with Joey behind you.
Well, I just got out of shape coming out of four. And I don't know why. I mean, I was just talking with Joey and Kyle trying to figure out why these cars react differently. They have a little bit more round of bumper, and they just seem to get lifted up a little bit more. You know, the cup cars look like when somebody's hooked to you, you can make moves. And, you know, just right there, I get sideways and it just stays on me, and I'm just going back and forth, and then just get hooked. I mean, I don't know. It's just, I think these Nationwide cars are going to react a little differently. You know, the cup guys all say they're a little more squirrely, but I don't know. It's going to be an interesting race. Unfortunately, you know, we got a teammate that's tore up. I think they're going to be able to fix it, but we got to go to a backup in our number 11 Short Lodge Toyota.
Now we're getting these smaller tapered spacers. As a driver, are you feeling that difference when you went out the second session?
No, we didn't go out and draft in the first session. So when they went to a smaller one, we went out and drafted. I mean, couldn't tell. This was like the draft to no draft. But, you know, they're going fast out there, but they seem in control until something happens, and then it just jumps up and bites you all of a sudden.
All right, Brian Scott to a backup.
Danica Patrick in the 7 just in front of this group.
That's a good observation, Phil. They do. Everything feels fine until something happens, and then you say, whoa, mama, I'm going fast.
If people always talk about what did it feel like to run 200 miles an hour, so well, it's all relative until you get in trouble and you're sideways, yeah. You're sliding down the racetrack, then man, does it feel fast.
When you're going 200 miles an hour and everybody else is going 200 miles an hour, it doesn't feel that big of a deal. But when you start slowing down, oh, does that get your attention? Stay with us. More Nationwide Series practice here on Speed. Get fired up for the duel. The new surface test NASCAR's best as they fight for position in the Great American Race. Get ready for two action pack races to set the field for the 500, the Gatorade Duel at Daytona. That's tomorrow, 2 Eastern, live on Speed. What a great shot of the moon.
Here's a great shot right here of Casey Kane lined up with Carl Edwards. They've already run almost 199 miles an hour hooked up like this. You can see 198.7.
You know what's amazing, Phil, and you talked about it earlier. It's relative to your surroundings, how fast they're going. Well, we just went by a car that was down on the apron. These guys are going over potentially 200 miles an hour right at it. We've had speeds of over 202 miles an hour, and a car going probably 60 on the apron looks like it was stopped.
And you can see the 38 of Casey Kane jumping around there. That is not a comfortable ride for him right there.
No, it isn't. And again, you're right now, if you wanted to say what would be the best time to go out and run a fast lap, this is it. I mean, you've got cool temperatures, the track's cool. Max grip, max everything right now. If whatever a car will run, it's going to run it tonight in this kind of air.
And a new smooth racing surface that everyone has confidence. Carl Edwards coming off of the racetrack now in his Ford Mustang. We go back to the garage and Wendy Venerini.
Thank you, Rick. We heard from Brian Scott. Now let's hear from Joey Logano. Describe in these Nationwide cars the draft and sucking up when you come up on cars like that.
Yeah, you know, we were just trying to, you know, me and Kyle did earlier, and, you know, trying to do a two-car draft like we did on the Cup side. And, you know, me and Kyle did it. It worked pretty good. So I was going to try out my other teammate in the 11 car. And, you know, I just got to him, and they single file out in front of us. OK, we'll just go underneath him and pass some cars here. And as soon as I got to him, we started pushing. And as soon as he started turning the wheel a little bit, it's just so light in the back of these things. It just turned him a little bit. And once he starts checking up, I can't get off him quick enough. And it's unfortunate for both of us, for the GameStop Toyota and the 11 car there. It's, you know, both under the Gibbs banner there. So that's a tough one to swallow. But I think they'll be able to fix mine. You know, just I got when I checked up, I got run over from behind. And you know, it's just kind of part of it there. But, you know, it's a tough gig. You know, it's my fault because I was pushing him. But it's just it's product of it. You know, it's going to happen eventually, I think. I think all of us just trying to get used to it out there and seeing how we can do with these new cars.
All right, thanks to Joey Logano. A learning curve on both series. And for more on Brian Scott, let's head over to Ray Dunlop.
And, Wendy, while Brian was over on your side of the garage talking to Joey Logano, he had been determined that there was going to be a backup car. They pulled it off the hauler. But after a further investigation down here, the team has decided they are going to repair this particular car that they've got sitting in the garage. It didn't look to me at all like it went into the clip, and they have found out that it's just cosmetic damage. They'll have to repair the rear deck, the spoiler, and the left rear quarter panels, but they're going to work, and NASCAR has told them they'll give them some extra time in the garage tonight to get their work done.
Thank you, Ray. So a difficult situation to start off the second practice for the 11 of Brian Scott. He gets into the wall as we see speeds over 202 miles an hour out of Tony Stewart. Speed's coverage of NASCAR Nationwide Practice from Daytona is brought to you by Gillette Fusion Pro Glide. Turn shaving into gliding and skeptics into believers. And by Best Western, the world's biggest hotel family. Who would have thought you could have seen that beautiful moon when we had the rain that started the day off today and a cloud cover? But now the sky is clear. The Nationwide Series practice underway.
I think this is the only place in the whole United States that rained today.
You think it was it?
People were texting, you know, on Twitter were saying, hey, man, I'm over here in Orlando and it's beautiful. And I'm 10 miles from the racetrack. It's beautiful.
But how about these speeds, DW? Yeah.
Hey, listen, that's faster than the Cup cars. And you know, they're not. I don't think we're going to be able to tolerate that. Now, this is what I consider to be the next generation of a Cup car. The look of these cars, the new look of a Nationwide car. But I don't think they were expecting them to go quite this fast.
Joe Nemechek back out on the racetrack in his number 87.
Joe's out there running by himself, looking to make a mock qualifying run. Joe is locked in to Sunday's Daytona 500 by virtue of his speed and qualifying on Sunday. So I know there's a lot of relief in that camp.
That is a great accomplishment for Joe and Felipe Lopez and his whole crowd. Come down here, have the fastest Toyota, and put that thing in the field with that speedy run. That's pretty impressive.
It sure is.
As soon as we've seen a couple single car runs, a group of about six is now heading into turn number one. So we're seeing the pack form up once again. Seven cars, it looks like, come off of pit road, begin to line up.
It's a big pack forming right there.
Some good fast cars here. We ought to see probably see some faster than 202 miles an hour with this group.
Yeah, there's Kyle Busch, the 18 car. He's going to peek to the outside for just a moment. Sam Hornish, the 12 car in that group as well.
Kenny Wallace in the 09 just in front of this group. Again, Tony Stewart, 202.238 miles per hour. What NASCAR wanted to see in this second practice.
I was talking to Rusty Wallace, and he was telling me about Kenny's car, and he said, DW, Kenny's got one of the best cars of anybody down here in the wind tunnel. He said it really was good in the wind tunnel, and they got some good power on the hood. Wouldn't surprise me if old Herman doesn't get up there and get it done.
J.R. Fitzpatrick in the 27 car for Baker Curb Racing.
You ever seen him race on dirt, Kenny Wallace?
Yes, absolutely.
Man, he's a wheel man in a dirt car.
Yes, he is.
Holy smoly.
It's Mike Wallace right behind it. Kenny Wallace. A little family affair taking place up front.
Yeah.
Look, watch this now. Watch these two cars get hooked up together. J.R. Fitzpatrick and Kyle Busch.
Hope J.R.'s ready for a ride.
We hope he keeps it pointed the right direction.
That's what I'm telling you. Look at those hands in there. They look pretty nervous to me.
Let's watch this 18 car. Remember how bad he was bottoming it out last
time? We're not up for that.
Last time he was on the racetrack.
I don't know who he is. Just a second. I'll try to.
That's exactly what I was thinking. Kyle, are you sure you want to be doing this? Because, I mean, JR's a great guy and all that, but I don't know how much experience he's got drafting with somebody pushing him like this.
He had a top five finish in a truck race here two or three years ago, so he does have some experience here at Daytona.
Kyle says, how about you follow me, dude?
Going into turn three.
In behind you, two back.
Eric Almirola, we saw him running by himself. He ran 3.5 seconds slower by himself than he had in the draft.
Yeah.
3.5 seconds.
Well, that's the dilemma. Think about this. The Cup cars qualified at 184 miles an hour. They route their race practicing or drafting at 202, 3, 4, 5, 6 miles an hour.
Again, this pick that, or the pack that started off with 7 cars is broken into a couple 2-car packs. Let's go back to the garage and Ray Dunlap.
Well, we want to hear from Carl Edwards. He's looking up at the monitor. We're getting a 2-car draft here, just kind of like the Cup Series. Tell me about your observation of how different these two divisions are and how the cars are reacting on the racetrack.
These are much faster, much scarier to drive. I was just going down to look at Casey's car. The way the front bumper on this Mustang matches up to the rear bumper on his car, it's like I've got a little shelf there, and I feel like I'm going to pop his rear bumper up on that shelf and lift his rear end up, and I don't want to do that. So we're going to go look at that. We might work on doing anything we can to make that front end as slick as possible so that it doesn't catch the guy in front of me. But, man, that's fast. When he was pushing me, I mean, that is as fast as I've gone here in a long time, and it feels great. Just hoping we can keep the car in one piece for the end of the race.
With these high speeds, Carl, in both divisions that we've seen so far, it's kind of a moving target on the rules package. Do you expect more to come down from NASCAR in this division?
I think we have enough practice left that I do expect more. And I don't know if that's good or bad. I don't know if it's better for us to be in a 2-car pack breaking away and running faster, or if it's better for us to all be together. I don't know which is safer. We're just going to go race with whatever rules they give us. And Mike Beam's built such a great Fastenal Fusion, Fastenal Mustang. Sorry about that. I do that a few times every week now. But this Fastenal Mustang is awesome. And we just don't want to tear it up before the race starts. That's our number one goal.
All right. Good luck to you. That is Carl Edwards. He's going to go down the garage and take a look at how his car is lining up with some others.
Guys, one thing I wanted to illustrate about this rear bumper, you see, right, we were looking at Carl Edwards' car earlier in that first practice session, and right here at the bottom is where that bumper looked like it had been pushed. Now, I was looking at Jeff Gordon's car in the last Sprint Cup practice, Daryl, and the area that was being pushed was more like this. So I think that's the big difference, and maybe what's making it more difficult to hook up and push with these Nationwide cars than it is the Cup cars.
Yeah, if you look at the, we're looking at the rear of this car. If you go around and look at the front, the front of these cars, the bumper is rounder, and therefore it's not flat like a Cup car is. The bumper and front nose on a Cup car is absolutely flat against each other. And these cars, there's a little bit of a roundness to the front bumper, and that's where they're getting that lift and that kind of getting you loose and giving you that squirrely feeling.
And already we've had an issue. We see teammates running nose to tail. Mike Lynette just in front of that 66, Steve Wallace. More Nationwide Series practice here on Speed, Motorsports Authority. In just 2 days, the world's toughest truckers hit the high banks for the season opener. With a new track surface, speeds will be lightning fast and mistakes will be costlier. And once the green flag drops, it's 3 wide and full throttle. Don't miss the NASCAR Camping World Truck Series from Daytona. That's Friday, 6 Eastern, right here on Speed.
What a great show that's always been here at Daytona. Look for nothing different come Friday night.
Well, I wonder how fast these the trucks are going to run for.
Well, we have 46 trucks here for 36 spots. So 10 guys are going to be disappointed before that event even starts. Now the top speeds. You see Tony Stewart and Brad Keselowski over 202 miles an hour in this second practice. In the first practice, we saw them hit 200 miles an hour. NASCAR said, let's bring that tapered spacer down a bit, we'll choke down the horsepower, we'll see if we can get the speeds to go down. Instead, two cars were faster.
Yeah, well, they in the first practice, everybody was kind of all over the place. I think they were doing some single car runs. There wasn't the tight packs like we have here. We've had a number of good 6, 8, 10 car draft cars out here drafting. That's where that big speed comes from. You're closing. You don't run that big speed by being up front by yourself. You're catching a pack of cars, and you come up on them, and that closing rate is about 10 mile an hour faster than the cars in front of you, and that's where you get that big speed from. We used to do it all the time if we wanted to get a little TV time. Put a little tape on the grill, fall back off a big pack of cars, and get
a
big, big run, and come up, and it's a holy cow, where'd that come from?
And NASCAR is aware of that. They have people, officials up in the control tower watching things, and they will see if somebody does have a run on somebody, and that's where they get that big number.
Winnie Venerini. He's caught up with Casey Kane.
Yeah, Carl Edwards just made his way over to the garage area, and Casey Kane and he are describing what they were feeling in the race car with their noses. They've walked through this garage and looked at a Chevy nose, looked at a Ford nose, looked at the Toyota noses, trying to compare how these cars are hooking up to each other as the conversation continues to go on. We talked to you, Carl, about how these cars are hooking up. What's the conversation about what you've learned in this practice session?
Well, we're just trying to figure it out with the different makes, and I feel like when I was pushing him, it was really simple. You know, his car didn't move around. When he was pushing me, my car moved a lot more. So it's kind of sketchy, and if he's got a lip like above his kind of his grill there, he could easily just carry me, right, like in circles, I guess. So that's what he was looking at. It's pretty close, but I felt really good pushing him.
All right, and there you have it. Casey and Carl both describing how they're hooking up in this draft in the Nationwide Garage.
And remember, the front ends of these race cars are looking more like the cars that they're supposed to emulate, the Challenger, the Mustang, which looks a lot like a Mustang you'd see on the street. Stay with us. More practice here on Speed. Friday, the biggest party in Daytona gets revved up. Tune in as Brian Vickers talks about his return to Sprint Cup competition. Plus, Michael Waltrip reminisces about the life of Dale Earnhardt and the drama of the 2001 Daytona 500. It's all on NASCAR Trackside from Daytona starting at 6 Eastern on Friday.
Really anxious for that show. Getting to talk to Mikey about the book and, you know, his reminiscing of Dale Sr. and what it was like to work for him. And then, of course, Brian Vickers. And what a comeback that's been, and what a great story that is.
Great story, getting Brian Vickers back behind the wheel.
Good little draft right here. You know what we were talking about? Casey Kane was talking about how the noses differ. In the Sprint Cup cars, we see that Camry logo on that 18 car. Below that, it's common among all the makes. It's the exact same piece that a Toyota or a Chevrolet or a Ford or a Dodge would have. These cars have a little bit more character and a little bit more manufacturer specific, so that's why the difference you have in these Nationwide cars.
Yeah, it's just flat. Really, the difference, flat on the Cup car, flat to flat. Here you got flat and a round, and that round is what's lifting these cars up and moving around like that.
Does it surprise you that these two guys are drafting together, Kyle Busch and Brad Keselowski, right now?
Not at all.
Really?
Yeah. You know, down here, and you just heard him talking about, you're looking for brand. You're looking for the best combination. Is that 22 car a Dodge? Is that a good car to be pushing my Toyota? Now let me try. Let me get behind him and let me see how my car is behind him. So right now you're just testing.
Yeah, they just ran a lap at 199 in the other configuration. Now this lap's going to be slower because of the switch. And these guys may not like each other. Now they obviously had some issues last year. They may still not like each other. But on the racetrack, they want to get with the best player they can get with, and both of them know that the other guy is one of the best in the world, so it just absolutely makes perfect sense for these guys to run together.
I don't like the way that Dodge looks, so man, with that Toyota behind him, it's moving that car around a lot. It looks like it's almost trying to lift it up.
They might not have to like each other, but they've at least got to respect each other on the racetrack, especially going 200 miles an hour.
It's easy. You don't have to work for me. Just don't work against me.
Speaking of working against, never mind. Ray.
Oh, that wasn't a very good segue, Ray. But I do want to show you a little bit about what I think Daryl's talking about. He's talking about this contour coming around this way. But I want to show you the Mustang. If I lay my Sharpie on there, you can see that this is a flat edge. It'll sit there. It's no problem. And what Carl Edwards is saying is when he gets his car really low down in the front, the guy's bumper in front of him is coming up on top of this ledge. Now, let's look at the Chevrolet right over here. Here's Eric Almirola's car, right? If I take my Sharpie and put it here, it just falls off. There's no ledge there, so this bumper contour comes around here, and because there's this angle there, it's a little bit different, and I want to get the opinion of the driver here. Eric Almirola, you got a beautiful-looking Chevrolet this weekend, but I'm curious, when you're on the track, can you tell when you're with a different make and how these cars are reacting differently?
Not really. So far, I've seen very similar characteristics, no matter who I'm behind or is behind me. I know that the Chevrolet of mine and Dale Jr.'s hooked up is really fast together. So we just went out there and run. I think I run like three or four laps before I started getting too hot. But our car, our GT Vodka Chevrolet, is really fast, and really proud of all our guys at Junior Motorsports. They've worked really hard all winter, and it's showing here. We fastest in the first practice and third here, so got a really good car, and I'm excited about Saturday.
All right, guys, so I did all that work to show you how different they are, and he said, there's no difference.
We know, Ray. Yeah. We know.
At least Ray could have went and helped him wipe off the front end of that car while he was doing that.
Or maybe he could use the Sharpie and fill in some of those marks on the front end. Tony Stewart has the fastest speed, 202 miles an hour here at Daytona. Speed presentation of NASCAR Nationwide Practice from Daytona is presented by Napa, Napa Know-How. Brought to you in part by DirecTV. Don't just watch TV, DirecTV. Call 1-800-DIRECTV. And by GEICO, 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. Visit geico.com for a free rate quote. And we talked about the way they line up. And here is a couple shots of two cars, and we'll show you both ways.
Well, this is a pretty good marriage right here. You see how that's pretty flat? They look like they're touching in quite a bit of surface. The problem they have with these cars is this nose is round. And that's where the car that's what's moving the car in front around quite a bit. So that's a Toyota pushing a Dodge. And that doesn't look too bad. I think I could probably live with that. But now this, on the other hand, here, you've got just that teeny bit of area that you're pushing with, plus you're pushing right on the bottom of the bumper, and that's trying to lift that car up a little bit. And I think that's what's making that Toyota not happy with that Dodge behind it. You can see there's not a lot of pushing there, surface, and that moves the car around a lot.
That's a great illustration, too. There's so much more surface area one way than the other.
Yeah. And that's what you're looking for, as much flat as you can get. And that way you can push, keep the car pushing straight all the time. And that's what I think happened to Brian Scott off of four there. Because of the roundness of the front of the car, once his car started to wobble just a little bit, it was running back and forth across that bowed bumper, and that's what spun him out.
The Chevrolet running on her own out on the racetrack. Wendy?
Well, she's running on her own, Rick, but it's not because she wants to. She's actually been looking for some drafting partners out there, but it seems like everybody's in the garage right now. So she's out there making some single car runs, but she is on the radio trying to find a drafting partner. She wants more practice time in the draft, and she was also trying to pick up to the nose in front of her, to the bumper in front of her with her nose, and that's why she wanted some more experience. She's not quite happy with hooking up in that draft yet, but not getting it right now with all the cars in the garage.
Well, Wendy, I mean, honestly, there's only two other cars on the racetrack. Her crew chief, Tony Erie Jr., ought to bring her down pit road, park her down here, and wait for a group of cars to come out if she wants to run with somebody.
And one of the problems is this practice is only scheduled to go for about another 5 minutes. So time running out on Danica as far as drafting practice. Jason Leffler, Reed Sorensen, talking a little bit about what's going on the track. Under the lights at Daytona International Speedway here at Daytona Beach, Florida, the Nationwide Series practice winding down. Danica Patrick couldn't find any dance partners out on the racetrack. She's still running around there, a single car effort.
Yeah, and just the problem is you're running out of time. Everybody's already made all the runs they're going to make, and so right now she's just getting some laps in by herself, which, really is not all that helpful.
In her situation, she was here a year ago, ran the ARCA race from Daytona, and then was able to run the Nationwide race the next week, so she did get some drafting practice on this racing surface, but it's a new racing surface this year.
I was going to say, she came here last year and she said, well, I left here, I got some experience, kind of know what to expect. We're back here. It's nothing like it was when she left here a year ago. They've changed everything here but the zip code. I mean, it's all brand new Pima. It's got a ton of grip, track smooth, whole different kind of racing.
Final minute, really, of practice for Nationwide. Josh Wise coming onto the track and trying to get a couple last laps in.
This is actually a Roush car. This is one of the, I think, four cars entered by Jack Roush, Roush Fenway.
Good little kid. I like Josh a lot.
Good-looking car. Cajun Industries on board.
Mustang looks like a Mustang, doesn't it?
It does.
Wow. Hadn't seen that in a long time.
Ray Dunlap
Well, guys, this is the tapered spacer that they came with before practice started earlier today. Obviously, they've gotten a smaller one. The big question is, will NASCAR bring us a smaller one yet? The speeds have been very, very fast, but what everyone in this garage is telling me, you can put this on and it'll slow them down by themselves, but in the group, they're still going to be lightning fast.
Yeah, and they certainly have been, Ray, over 202 miles an hour in this practice session. Our first practice session earlier today, just over 200 miles an hour was the fastest time.
Yeah, and the problem with slowing them down by themselves is the closing rate. Every time you slow the cars down, the closing rate is that much faster, and that's kind of dangerous.
The Cup Series, we've seen them run 2x2. The Nationwide Series, will we see big packs run around the track?
By all means, just because what we showed you about the way the cars line up and the way they bump draft and everything, totally different kind of racing.
Been a great day here at Daytona International Speedway. We're going to slip back to the Charlotte studios for